Here now is H.M.S. Richards, the voice of prophecy speaker. His subject, History Proves God Spoke the Truth.
Theodore Roosevelt said of Abraham Lincoln, he built up his entire reading upon his early study of the Bible. He mastered it, as later he mastered only one or two other books. He mastered it so that he became almost a man of one book, who knew that book and instinctively put into practice what he had been taught therein. The Holy Bible is the constitution of the Christian Church. Its own message proves it to be true. More than this, its prophecies of great nations fulfilled in history prove that God spoke the truth. He alone knows the future. And it is written in the prophecy of Isaiah 46:10 that he declares the end from the beginning. In Amos 3:7, we find the statement that God revealeth his secret unto his servants the prophets. The prophetic book of Daniel is one of the most important in the Bible. A few days before his death upon the cross, our Savior urged the importance of reading and understanding the prophecy of Daniel. You'll find it in Matthew 24:15. Surely a Christian needs no other encouragement to study, to believe, to attempt to understand the great prophecies of Daniel. In the second chapter of the book of Daniel, we found the prophecy of the great image, its separate parts representing the great nations of history, down to the end of time. In the seventh chapter, which we will notice today briefly, we have the same territory traversed in a different way. Daniel, now an aged man, but still in government employ, was given a divine vision of the future. Remember, Babylon was still a world power. Beginning with the second verse, we find these words, "I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heavens strove upon the great sea. And four great beasts came up from the sea," diverse one from another. These are Bible cartoons of great nations. In symbolic language, the sea, or waters, represent multitudes of peoples or nations. In Revelation 17:15, it is said, "The waters which thou sawest are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues." You see, there's no guesswork. We have a plain scripture statement for it. The winds represent trouble or war, Jeremiah 49:36. As a result, then, of war and conflict on earth, four great nations arise, symbolized by four ravenous beasts, just as we cartoon nations today, the bear, Russia, the lion, Britain, the eagle, U.S., and so on. In verse 23 of this seventh chapter, we read, "The fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon earth." Well, then, of course, that's true. The third beast is the third, second, the second kingdom, and the first is the first kingdom. Now, the first was like a lion, had eagle's wings, corresponding to the head of gold in the second chapter. It represented Babylon. The wings, the speed of conquest under Nebuchadnezzar. The whole civilized world at that time brought in subjection to mighty Babylon, the glory of kingdoms. Of course, the eagle is the king of birds, just like the lion is the king of beasts. These symbols fitly picture the mighty nation of Babylon. In fact, in Habakkuk 1:8, the Babylonians are compared to eagles. But now the picture changes. The wings are plucked away. A man's heart, weak, timorous, afraid, is given to the lion. All these changes came to Babylon. Finally, on the night of Belshazzar's great liquor party, the Babylon went down in feasting, not in fighting, reveling, drunkenness. This is all in the fifth chapter of Daniel. A divine hand wrote upon the wall the words of doom. "Thou art weighed in the balances and found wanting, thy kingdom divided, given to the Medes and Persians." In 538, the world kingdom of Persia came upon the scene of action, represented by the second beast, like a bear, raising itself up on one side, having three ribs in its mouth, and devouring much flesh. This was a dual kingdom, like Austria-Hungary, Medo-Persia, a union of the Medes and Persians. It was a bloodthirsty power in those days. Three ribs may represent the triple alliance of Babylon, Libya, and Egypt, against which the bear fought and won the victory. But time flies on, and the scroll of history is unrolled. The great television of the nations is thrown upon the screen of time. After this I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard, which had upon it four wings, and the beast had four heads. This is the same as the bronze kingdom of Daniel, the second chapter. The leopard is capable of rapidity of motion. The four wings show still greater speed, the speed of Alexander's conquests. In 8 years, he marched his soldiers over 5,000 miles. The four heads no doubt represent the four divisions that followed after his death, in which his four leading generals divided his kingdom toward the four winds of heaven. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful, terrible, had iron teeth. It stamped everything with its feet that it did not eat. It was diverse from all the beasts that were before it. It had 10 horns. That's the 7th verse of Daniel 7. This is the Roman Empire, depicted by the iron legs of Daniel 2. The 10 horns out of this kingdom are the 10 kings or kingdoms that shall arise, representing the division of that great empire into the nations of Western Europe. It was during the rule of Rome that Jesus was born. Remember that Joseph and the Virgin had gone to Bethlehem to enroll for a taxation which had been ordered by Caesar Augustus, Emperor of Rome. The worldwide political organization of the Roman Empire, its worldwide system of roads, postal services, police, all tended to make it possible for the gospel to go quickly in that generation. It was a preparation for the first advent of our Lord. But as we read further in this 7th chapter of Daniel, we discover that after the 10 horns have appeared, and after the Roman Empire has been broken into its fragments, some strong, some weak, an 11th horn appears, uproots 3 of the others. This no doubt represents the rise of the power of religion, which to this very day has exerted a greater influence in Western Europe and the world than many would like to admit. Back in the Middle Ages, the influence of religion was almost supreme in many areas. The union of church and state was taken for granted. Even after the Reformation, it continued in many lands. This is an additional line of truth introduced into the prophecy of the 7th chapter of Daniel, not found in the 2nd chapter. It would be well for us all to study again the history of the Christian church from the beginning. Its rise and persecution during the days of the Roman Empire, the story of political religion during the Middle Ages and into modern times, its wonderful history of the Reformation, important, interesting events regarding the Roman Catholic Church, the Protestant accession of the Christian Church, right down to our own time. We cannot go into this now, but these things are considered in our free Bible correspondence courses. After bringing us down to our own days, this prophecy introduces the great judgment scene of Daniel 7, 9th verse and onward. I beheld till the thrones were cast down or placed, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, his wheels as burning fire. 1,000,000s ministered unto him, 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were opened. This is one of the most sublime scenes in all literature. Look at it. Think of it. How will we stand in the judgment? Think of the vast host of angels before the throne. 10,000 times 10,000, that's 100,000,000. What a scene. The judgment set, the books opened. Each of us a case in court. Each of us a record in those books. And the dead were judged out of those things which are written in the books. Revelation 20, verse 12. Some people never think of the judgment day. It's said that in a certain burying place in Poland, there are a number of tombstones that have no name or other inscription on them. The idea is that in the last day, the day of judgment, the angel of eternal life will call the sleepers, the good to bliss, the wicked to punishment. Some felt that if no name was on the stone, it might be passed over. But not so, for it's written by the apostle in Hebrews 9, 27. It is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. Really, friends, in any act of sin, we judge ourselves. A bishop once said to Louis XI of France, "Make an iron cage for all those who do not think as we do, an iron cage in which the captive can neither lie down nor stand up straight." Such a cage was fashioned, an awful instrument of torture. After a while, this same bishop offended Louis XI, and after 14 years, he was in that very cage, and could neither lie down nor stand up. This calls to mind the words of Jesus, "With what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged, and with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again." Matthew 7, 2. We should be exceedingly careful how we attribute unjust motives to others and judge them wrongly. We cannot read the human heart. God can and will. We read now 2 more verses of this prophecy of the 7th chapter of Daniel, verse 13 and 14. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man, that's Jesus, came with the clouds of heaven, and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom, that which shall not be destroyed. So this prophecy, like the one in the second chapter, brings us to the final victory. Christ appears for us in judgment. He stands for us there. His kingdom is to be set up. He is our peace with God. He answers for us before God. He pleads, "My blood, my blood." In the old days in Russia, a father's heart was well nigh broken by the prodigality of his son, who was addicted to the vice of gambling. He thought that a change of location would help his boy, so sent him to St. Petersburg. But there he only went from bad to worse. Then, through his father's influence, he secured an appointment in the army. There he went still farther down. It seemed to have reached the end of it all. One night, sitting in his tent adding up his accounts and debts, he was in great desperation. He wrote across the bottom of the column these words, "Who can pay all these debts?" The Emperor of Russia, passing down the long row of tents, saw a light still burning and looked in. The boy had fallen asleep, his head in his arms. The Emperor, glancing at the figures before him on the table, read the question. He recognized the situation. He wrote below it all these words, "I will, Alexander." So let us face the judgment decision now in Christ, who under our question, "Who will pay all this debt of my sins?" has written, "I will, Jesus." Yes, sweetest note in seraph song, sweetest name on mortal tongue, sweetest carol ever sung, Jesus, blessed Jesus.